Good afternoon and welcome to the Department of Psychology, Arts and Science for Women. Interpersonal skills play a major influence in our lives, especially in the workplace, because they affect job performance, which in turn helps to decide the outcome of a company's success. Equally important are social and emotional competence, which refers to the skills that help us to interact in positive ways with others and manage our own emotions. It is indeed a relevant topic in the current scenario where the nature of skills needed in the job industry are changing at a fast pace. On behalf of the management, principals, and faculty members of Dr. M.J.R. Janki College of Arts and Science for Women, I extend a warm welcome to Dr. Maya Ritha Sabhapathi, Associate Professor in Psychology, Vellore Institute of Technology, Chennai. She's a passionate teacher and an avid researcher who's very keen in doing interdisciplinary and collaborative research with foreign universities. She has completed her PhD in psychology from Indian Institute of Technology, Chennai, in 1991. She's guiding 6 PhD scholars in the areas of educational psychology, social psychology, neurocognitive psychology, and disability studies. She's organized many national and international seminars and conferences. She has participated and presented papers in numerous conferences in India and abroad. She has completed 3 major research projects funded by the ICSSR, Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, Government of India, and the Government of Tamil Nadu. She has numerous accolades to her name, such as the All India Rank 2 and 1st Rank in IIT Madras, Gold Medalist in MA Industrial Psychology, Madras University, Merit Certification in Certified Recruitment Analyst, Best Faculty Award from the Vellore Institute of Technology, Research Awards for Funded Projects in Vellore Institute of Technology, and the Best Contribution Award from the Indian School Psychology Association in 2019, to name a few. It's a privilege to have you with us today, ma'am.
Thank you.
I would also like to welcome the staff and students of Dr. M.J.R. Janki College and other colleges who have registered for the webinar. Before I hand over the session to the resource person, I would like to inform all the participants that the feedback form will be displayed in the chat box while the webinar is going on. The submission of feedback is mandatory for the issue of e-certificates. You may also post your doubts or questions in the chat box, and it will be answered towards the end of the session. Now, may I request Dr. Maya Ritha Sabhapathi to kindly take over.
Good evening, everybody. I first thank the management and the HOD for inviting me. It's a great pleasure to be here. And it gives me a joy to talk to people, because it's an opportunity. Maybe I would not have done it if not for Corona. But the main thing here is, we are giving all these talks because we have the time to spend at leisure, at home, and try to understand. The main purpose of this talk is to understand ourselves. Please understand that when you're attending this talk, you're not doing anybody any favor. You are going to do something to better yourself. That's what is most important. Okay, as ma'am said, she gave a very good introduction talking about how interpersonal skills are important today and importance of social and emotional competency. So you've got an idea of what I'm going to speak about. So here I think I have a group of students as well as some faculty members who have joined. I thank you all for participating, and I hope it's going to be fruitful for all of you. So first thing that I would like to tell you is, what is interpersonal relationship? Why is it that it's so important that we are discussing? Please understand, interpersonal relationship is nothing but how we interact with each other. And when you're interacting with each other, please remember, we are not, it is not basic communication. It is not just transfer of message. In interpersonal skills, we are dealing with how you're dealing with the other person's emotions, how you're dealing with how he is reacting to people, how he is trying to respond. So there are two different things, how you react and how you respond. When you're going to, for example, if say a scorpion is going to fall on your dress or something, it's going to be an impulsive reaction where you just throw it off. You're not going to bother who's in front of you. The first thing is let me take it away from me. That is what is basic a basic reaction response. But we are talking about a response. It is which is having a little bit of thinking in it, a little bit of reasoning, and then you are responding to the given stimuli. Now, what happens is generally in interpersonal relationship, we never had this problem before. Please understand, none of us are having any problem even now. We never had this problem before, but today we are having this problem because all of us are under stress. Nobody is to be blamed. That is the irony of the situation. So when somebody is saying I'm having a problem with X is having a problem with Y, it is not that X is a problem or Y is a problem. It's a given situation which is problematic for both because they themselves are having some unresolved conflicts, some unresolved problems. The situation is adding on to it, and so on and so forth. So first, let us, as all of you know, as psychologists, we all know there's no right or wrong behavior. The behavior is something that which we try to respond in a positive, polite way, not hurting others as well as yourself. So this is how it is. So if you're going to ask me who is an intelligent person, you'll all may say, oh, IQ should be 110, 120, 132, all those things. Actually, that doesn't matter at all. Here, when I talk about intelligence, it's how well you adapt to the environment. That's a basic criteria for measuring one's intelligence. So what we have to do here is, we just have to think about it in a very, very simple way that intelligence is nothing but the way we adapt with one another. So next question is, now, why do we need to interact with people? First, let us try to understand, this is not a new concept. This has been happening since dawn of civilization. People have been interacting. See, those days it was very pleasant, calm, because people had the time, the number of people were less, the expectation was less, the pressure was less. They could do it at their own ease, and things like that was very comfortable for everybody to be on their best behavior because they had an opportunity, the environment also was conducive. Now, what is happening in today's scenario is just the opposite. So here, as I told you, it is a reciprocal, social, emotional kind of interaction between two people. So again, I mentioned to you, it is a reciprocal, social and emotional interaction. So the two keywords are social. Social meaning in a given context. How do we behave in a given context? And how do we behave differently with different people? The next one is emotional. So when you talk about emotional, all of us know, all of you are psychology students, all of us know all different types of emotions, all that we have done. So theory is different and practical way of reacting to given situation is very different. So here in an interaction, what is your kind of emotional response, your social response, and the way you act? As you know, behavior is nothing but ABC, the affective tone, the behavioral component, and the cognitive component. Since you're psychology students, I want to talk to you in those terms. So these are the three components, and all these components are involved during an interaction. So now we have to moderate each of it depending on the situation that we are. The next thing is, we're going to talk about what are the different barriers to interpersonal relationship. So basic barriers could be personal barriers, situational barriers, social cultural barriers. So when you're talking about personal barriers, what are they? So personal barriers are those which are there because of our own kind of personality. So all of us, what is personality? Personality is nothing but a group of traits that remain consistently for a given period of time. So if you're going to be erratic in your behavior, and then you will not call that particular trait as something as your personality. That is, in a given situation, you responded like that. The next thing is, so we are going to talk about why do we respond differently, or why is it there is some kind of negative responses which we actually do not want to do, but it happens. Some reasons are your personal kind of factors. So first personal factor could be how effective we are in communication. All of us are communicating all the time, but how effective we are. For us to communicate, first and foremost, we should be right. We should have the right tone, choose the right words, see the right time to deliver the message, see the state of the listener, see the state of the environment. And then if you're going to be so careful in communicating, then you can be well assured that your interpersonal relation would be good. Wrong time, wrong thing said, then there could be a problem between the two people. It's not that it was intended. It was just that either of us were not careful when we were trying to pass on a message. The next thing is, a problem with interpersonal skills could be, one is your distorted self-concept. So what is self-concept? Self-concept is nothing but your physical self, your emotional self, your intellectual self, your social self, and your state of self-worthiness. So these are all our kind of parts of our self-concept. So when any of this is not as it should be or as it's expected, then our interaction will be affected. For example, if I'm going to have a very low self-esteem, and I have a low self-esteem, and therefore I have a complex, then how would I interact with people? If I see some achiever, I'll be always thinking that he's abusing me or he's thinking too much of himself. The problem is that person is acting normal, like he's acting to anybody else. But because of our kind of problems, we look at them differently, and therefore we try to react differently. The next thing is lack of flexibility. This is a very big problem that we are having. We always believe that what we are doing or what we are thinking is always right. It's not so. It is just that we are still learning, and as we are learning, as we are growing, we are also have to keep changing according to the requirement of the environment. Please understand that there is no one complete success formula for all type of behavior. This could have worked out in this context, that could have worked out in another context, but it's not going to work out always. The next thing is fear of rejection. What do you mean by fear of rejection? Why is it that we are interacting differently with different people? I'm comfortable with some people, I'm not comfortable with others. The basic reason is I'm comfortable with a group where I'm very sure that they're accepting me, or they will willingly accept me. But if I go to another group, I always have a fear of rejection. Because of this fear of rejection, I'm not giving my best. I'm very conscious of my behavior. I'm too watchful. And therefore, I might tend to become timid, or I try to withdraw or avoid. So when this kind of withdrawal avoidance is happening in an interaction, what happens is that could be misinterpreted as she's arrogant, she's not interested, or things and so on and so forth. But here the actual problem was that you had the fear of rejection. Another important thing is, most of the time we are not attempting many things because not that we lack skills, because we lack the or we fear failure. So most reasons for us not attempting anything in this world is fear of failure rather than lack of skills. So this I want to tell to my young friends, there's nothing that we cannot do. We can keep doing it, we can try, and failure is as common as success. So there's nothing to worry. And if people will understand, people will appreciate, because everybody is now becoming more understanding, where they say, okay, this child is trying, let her try, no problem, at least she's tried. So because of this fear of failure, kindly do not stop attempting. The next one is, in any relationship, there should be trust and honesty. This is very important, because what happens, you're all school, college friends, and you may be faculty and all that. So what do we do? You know, generally, today's tendency of human nature is, as soon as you get into a group, what you do is, you first want to build a trust or build a relationship. So we are building a relationship, we are all on our best behavior. Okay, we want inclusiveness, we want to be in the group. So we do everything to please the group norms. Then what happens is, that was not your real self. You just did to get membership. How long can you pretend? Not for long. Then your true nature comes out. When your true nature comes out, there is a problem. So what I would say is, even if you want to go into a group, let them accept you the way you are or what you are. And you just have to show your willingness to change. See, this is where our problem is. It's not that we cannot do. It's not that we are not capable of doing. We can do. We are capable. But the question of The willingness to change is not there. There's always some kind of resistance. As you all know, as psychologists, we always have a resistance to change. Why do we have resistance to change? Because we want to be in our comfort zone. Whatever it is, whichever way we are comfortable, we continue to want to be in that immaterial of our progress. This is where we are making a big mistake. Yes, young people, I always tell my students, if you are in a comfort zone, take it from me, you're not progressing. This is a very, very important, a key indicator of your progress. If you're going to say everything is fine, everything is doing well, that means you're not trying anything new. You're not trying something that is difficult. So we have to be careful with that. The next thing is, feeling of compatibility. Lack of compatibility is a very, very important factor where you talk about how you people are doing what you're doing. We should be willing to be compatible with one another. That's the next thing. So these, and then next thing is, there could be certain people who are having some kind of neurotic or psychotic problems. And again, in an interrelationship, if you are not willing to be open to find out that if there is a difficulty, if you're not willing to go for some kind of counseling or medical help, then you are at a risk of losing a membership in the group. You're not able to interact with them properly. People are misunderstanding you. Once there is misunderstanding, what happens is you are unable to cope up with them. So this was your personal barrier. Now let us go on to see the situational barrier. So situational barrier, sometimes situations are under control and sometimes they are not. Most of the time they are not. And a very simple thing is, maybe when we are just going to start this program, we did not know that there's going to be a failure of current. Even I'm talking now, if there's a failure of current, we cannot do anything. So there could be certain things which are out of control, and sometimes situational factors may be out of control. The whole situation itself can be highly complex. The interaction setup can be itself very, very complex. For example, if you are in an organization, so all of you are going to go to an organization. Everything is fine in a college environment where teachers or faculty are very nice. They try to understand, they're supportive, they help you. But when you're going to an organization, the situation is very, very complex, and you should be very, very careful when you're interacting with people. I always tell my students, please be observant. You try to see what is happening to all. Please be patient. Please watch what's happening to others and learn from them rather than you try to experiment. Yes, when you're asked to, you do, till you're confident or till you understand the social milieu we are in. You have to be very careful. Again, is this lack of territoriality. That is, sometimes what happens is there are some unseen boundaries. In interrelationship, this we have to very well understand, students and faculty. Nobody tells us how far and no further. It's just that we have to have that extra sense to find out how much can we interfere or how much can we put our nose into their personal life or their professional life. Nobody likes it, because one thing is they I've quite old and I've seen life for some time. Today's thing is people are becoming very, very secretive. People want to achieve in silence. People want to show that after they win, they want to say, yes, I've got it. But those, we never had those problems, because we all used to say, I'm applying here, I'm doing this, I'm doing that. And we were free doing whatever we want, and we were willing to expose our experiences. But today it is very, 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 very difficult for us to do the same thing. The next thing is, we have the lack of time. Lack of time is a big problem where we have to understand how we are going to deal with it. The next type of barrier is your cultural, social barriers. So social barriers, social culture barriers are there. We all are coming from different places, different cultural groups, different ethnic groups. There's a lot of social diversity. There is language diversity, and so on and so forth. So these are the few things that we have to take care of. So this were these barriers that we're talking about. And now let me go on to talk to you about generally what is interrelationship and how are we going to go about it. Okay. So first thing that I would like to tell you is that when we are in a group, we have to understand that if you judge people, nobody is yours. But if you understand people, everybody is yours. So what I'm trying to say is, that we are all in a group. I'm trying to explain what I'm stating. We are all in a group. When you're in a group, if you start judging people, passing comments, sitting on a judgment seat and saying, he should have been like this, I expected him to be like this, this is not what he should have done, then what happens is, nobody is yours. Whereas, if you're going to be an understanding person, then every person in that group becomes yours. So if you judge people, nobody is yours. If you understand people, everybody is yours. Now, how do we, what is understanding? How do we develop this habit of understanding? Basically, to develop a habit of understanding, we have to kind of be open. Be open to the fact that people can make mistakes. We have both positive and negative factors, and we have to learn to nurture one another's growth. So your ability to hold on to one relationship does not depend on people around you, but basically it depends upon the yourself. So what I'm trying to say is, if you're saying I'm in a group and I'm not able to hold on to relationship, the problem could be sometimes yours. And if you're going to depend on other people so that the whole group or the relationship is going to work out, then it could be only accidental. But if you are taking an initiative and if you want a relationship to carry on, then it is possible. Again, I'm trying to say, you take the responsibility. You take the responsibility of saying, yes, I am going to make it work. Only then it will work. If things have to happen that way, it may happen, may not happen. And if at all it happens, it is accidental and nobody has put in direct effort. Another thing is, everybody wants to have relationships. So please understand this also. It is not that you only want to have good relationship. Everybody wants to have good relationship. Everybody wants people to smile at them. Everybody wants people to acknowledge them, understand them, accept them. So this is not only your need, but it's need of everybody. So this thing. So what happens is, in a given situation, everything was fine. Suddenly what happens is, there are no good or bad people. If you create an unpleasant atmosphere, then people act nasty. I repeat, if you're going to create an unpleasant atmosphere, people act nasty. There was no good or bad people. The atmosphere has instigated them to behave in such a way. So what all that you have to do is accept them, that this was a kind of temporary madness. This was the way he behaved. And then maybe he will get out of it rather than overreact to it. Another important thing I want to share is, when you're dealing with people, please remember, the message that people should understand is, for example, say my son broke a very delicate flowers, which was very dear to me. So what did I do is, I'll shout at him. So when I shout at him, the message should be, actually what you should say is, in words or you express it in other ways is, Beta, I'm angry with you because of your behavior, because you broke that. But that does not mean that I've stopped loving you. So try to distinct your response to a behavior rather than the person. So you understand what I'm trying to say? The message when you're working with somebody, when you say some faculty are there also listening, when you're working with somebody, you just tell them that you disagree to that particular behavior, and that does not mean to say you have rejected them, so that they don't feel that they are not accepted. Only their behavior was not accepted. But I like you as I liked you before. So this is the whole mistake comes is, when there's a particular kind of behavior that's untasteful, immediately we say, we don't like you. Because we don't stop and think, it's not that I don't like you. How did I like you just 1 minute back? And then I can hate you the very next minute when you did something that displeased me. It's just that particular action displeased me. Therefore, I don't like you. It's that particular behavior that I didn't like. It's not you. So we have to be very clear in this when we are interacting. Please be vocal. Please express yourself when such difficult situation comes. Another thing is, people are in a group not for the mere sake of inclusiveness. People are in a group just because people want to be understood. people want to be accepted. This is a very, very important thing. We just think people are there because for numbers, people are there. That's all for different reasons, for political purposes or for other reasons where just numbers matter. Now we are talking about interrelationship, which is a very close kind of interaction where both emotional and social competencies have to be developed and you have to try to improve the relationship. Okay. Another thing is, you have to accept that everybody has positive and negative aspects. And if you embrace all this, embrace the fact that there are people with some kind of positive aspects or positive factors, they have something really to appreciate, they also have not so good area or area to improve, then this shouldn't be a problem. Because as I was told by somebody, they're saying, if you want to work with ideal people, you go to heaven. Meaning to say, we are not going to find ideal people anywhere. So we are going to find people with their own flaws, with their own good qualities, and we have to learn how to adjust with them. See, our talent is not blaming. Our talent is to get the best out of everybody. As a leader, he is a facilitator. So even in a group, please, again, another problem. What we do is we sit back and say, if I'm not a leader, I will not be active. It's wrong. A team player can be an unassigned leader. Unassigned leader meaning who takes a kind of initiatives to improve the whole group performance. Then most people form relationship, and you understand when you form relationship, why do we form relationship? It is wrong if you think we are in a group because somebody wants something from us. No, we want to be in a group for our own personal benefit. I want to do something because I want some personal identity. I do something because this gives me a source of enjoyment. I want something because there is some recognition. I want something because I have a need to belong. So when you have so many factors in a group, let us start trying to think that what is it that I'm also benefited, and I also have to take initiative to make this relationship as good as possible and not turn it to something which is sour. Another important thing is, human relationship cannot be absolute. It is relative, because as you're all psychologists, you know, human behavior is dynamic. What I say today, I'm not going to say tomorrow. Though there could be one line of consistency, we change because at a given moment, a person behaves according to his need, his wants, his motivations, his desires, so on and so forth. Therefore, there is no kind of perfect or absolute human relationship. It is not possible. Another interesting thing is, if the relationship is going to be short-lived, then you can be very sure that if the relationship is short-lived, it's going to be very fine. If a relationship is going to be long-lived, then you can be very sure that there could be a kind of, it's not kind of misunderstanding, there could be a kind of effort that both have to make to keep it going. Okay. So what happens is, you may do your best, but your best may not be good enough for others. It's a very important thing. What happens is, when we are giving our best, we are trying to do our best and we are sincere about it. And what happens is, many times we get disappointed in a relationship. The point is, don't worry. It's just that your idea of best and their idea of best does not match. See, it is not that you have to blame the person because he's not accepted what you've done, but his expectations were different. So it's better to talk. Or you find out what is it that you want, is this this you want, which area do you want me to work, and so on and so forth. Next thing is, any interrelationship needs a lot of time and energy. Again, I'm trying to say, we need to spend time in building a relationship, maintaining a relationship, and continuing a relationship. This is very, very important that we always do it. And again, in a group, what happens is, what do we do is, sometimes we think when you're punishing others in a group, actually in the bargain, you are punished yourself. What do I mean by that is, it's not the question of being very, very, punishment and all those kinds of words are even, I think, less used now. You'll be all knowing that, right? We talk about positive reinforcement, we are talking about encouragement, we are talking about involvement, talking about mindfulness. So we are talking about different other social psychological factors that facilitate good behavior. So now we are not going to talk about negative reinforcement, all those was there. I'm still negative reinforcement is happening. I'm not saying it's not happening. But when we're talking in this context where we're not talking about your Pavlov's theory or your behaviorist theory, we're talking about in a group how we are behaving. Here, what we have understood is we're all grown-up adults. We know our responsibilities. We are trying to give our best. But there are sometimes that are problems occurring. So I'm taking this whole group as somebody who is willing, who is good, willing to learn, who is good and wants to give the best. So when this is the case, let us go always on a positive tone rather than the negative tone. Then another problem is in a group or in an interrelationship is our expectations are sometimes very, very unrealistic, unattainable. So this is where our problem comes. It is nice. We always say, keep pushing your bar high. All that is fine. But let us see if it's really attainable. Let us see if it is. And so another problem is we all have these ideal goals. All of you are psychologists, you know, we have an ideal goal, the real self, the ideal self, the actual self, the possible self. So these are the different things that we are living with. But when our expectations become unrealistic, then our relationship also will dwindle. Meaning to say, let us talk, let us try to find out what is the difficulties, how am I going to help, what is it that is preventing him to reach the goals, group's expectations or your expectations. Then it's very important in a relationship is nothing but you are in a state of being connected. We are being connected to one another all the time, and the connection is through, how is it? Through communication, through our feelings and our behavior. So as you are a group who understands, I'm trying to tell you, when we are interacting, we are not only communicating, we are communicating to a human being who has his own feelings, wants, desires, motives, unfulfilled desires, ambitions, his present state of condition. So all these factors are interacting. So as we know, we always say, no, there's no right or wrong behavior. It's a behavior that is a response to the given situation. So how you monitor it or how you try to develop it is up to you. Okay, now let me go on to show you some slides. And I hope I was loud and clear. And I will start showing you some slides where we'll talk about what are the different types of animals in us. I mean to say, just to make it less boring, I thought I'll add this to you. I'll share the slide now. Is this things shared?
Not yet, ma'am.
Ma'am, I'll share the screen now, ma'am. Is the screen shared, ma'am? Is the screen shared?
Not yet, ma'am.
Can you see the screen?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Can you see the PPT?
Not the PPT, the screen is being shown, ma'am.
Just I'll go to the PPT, please bear with me.
Yes, ma'am.
Can you see the PPT now?
Yes, ma'am, yes, ma'am.
Thank you. So we are talking about, so long we were talking about personal skills, interpersonal skills, and intrapersonal skills. So the personal skills were what, how we deal with one another. Intrapersonal skill is what happens within us. Interpersonal is what happens with others. Okay, now let me go on to talk to you. Okay, now very simple thing is, change at thoughts makes your behavior. Change at behavior makes your habits. Change your habits makes your personality. Change your personality, it's your destiny. So we'll end up saying, when you change your thinking, your destiny is changed. So now we'll go back to say what it is. So you know that all our behavior is managed by our thinking. And what happens is, if you're continuously behaving in a particular way, it becomes your habit. So all of us know, we do a certain things in a particular way, it becomes a habit. After that, what happens is, this habit, after some time, becomes your personality trait. And this personality trait becomes your destiny. And this destiny is what is there. Therefore, your thinking is your destiny. So let us see what is an ostrich in you. An ostrich is one who buries his head in the sand and refuses to surface reality or admit there in any problem. So this is what we're trying to say. An ostrich is one who buries his head in the sand. So who are these type of people? So what I'm trying to say is, there are a lot of kinds of animals within you, meaning to say there are a few kinds of characteristics that are very distinct to animals that are found in us. So you please keep ticking off where, what you are and what I am, I truly tick. Okay, so one who refuses surface reality or admit any problems. Who are these people? These are the people in a group who deny there's any problem existing. So what do they do is, they ignore the problem. Please understand, in a group, if you're ignoring the problem, people will either think you are arrogant or they will think you're disinterested, you're not interested in the group goal, and therefore, they might misunderstand you, but not knowing that you're not admitting the problem. The next thing is the giraffe in you. The one who looks on others and the program in a general feeling, I am above all this childish nonsense. So most of the time we do it. Yes, we do it. But is it necessary, or does every time that we need to behave like this? Because please understand, we should have that kind of, the thought, or you should kind of have that kind of large-heartedness where you think that we have learned, they are still learning. Once you have this kind of universal love or universal acceptance, you're not going to have that feeling that I am above all this childish nonsense. Excuse me, maybe 3 years back you were doing the same silly thing you were doing, which the other person is doing because he has not yet mastered it. Therefore, when you get this giraffe in you, you tell yourself, I too did this thing some time ago. Maybe he's still learning. So once I know that he's doing a mistake, it is my responsibility to start helping him to get over his difficulties. The next thing is the tortoise in you. One who withdraws from group, refusing to give his ideas or opinions. So who are these people? These people are what we call as social loafers. You would have all learned in social psychology majors, where these people who do not want to participate, who do not want to give ideas, if there is a gain, then they will try to say that I belong to the group, or if there was something that did not happen the way it should have, then they said, I did not contribute to it. Only if I would have said, things would have been different. Please understand, nobody stops you. You should have the courage to share your ideas, opinions with others. Fine, first go with that idea that all of them are not going to agree to what you say. Why should they? They will have their own ideas. They have their own thinking. But if you're able to convince your ideas by giving them some kind of, say, data or some kind of your experience or some kind of success story, then they will think over. Another problem, people, you please understand, their human tendency generally, and I've seen in men generally more, is first is to refuse, first is to avoid, first is to be very offensive. This is their first natural behavior. Very sad it is. The point is, they just want to cut off. They just don't want, they want to be in the comfort zone. They don't want to have change. And they're worried if you're going to bring about change, the attention will go to you. Therefore, they want to put you down. This is a challenge for you. If you have a tortoise in you, you have to just say, no, I'm going to come out with my ideas. I'm going to tell what I feel. I'll try to convince them. I'll give it a try. I'm not saying that it's going to happen. Next thing is a peacock in you. One who is showing off, competing for attention. See what a fine fellow I am. Good. Nice to feel proud. We should have moments of pride. Moments of success gives us pride. But that should not turn into arrogance. So when you have succeeded something, you have tasted that joy. You have tasted, you accomplished something. The next thought that should come is, let me see more people do it. I understand we're looking very, very altruistic way of behavior. But as you grow, I think we tend to become like that. I got it. Let him also enjoy. For example, when you were children, when you're at home, in your family, when you eat something, you say it's very nice. Come on, you also eat it. You do it with your family. You do it with your husband, your wife. You do it with your children. Why can't it let's spread it over when you're having relationship, which may not be so closed it, but in a given situation like a college or an office, we can do it, right? Please understand, you have proved you're a winner. And it's over. People have accepted you are a winner. But if you're going to be arrogant about your winning, then after a point, people say you're a show-off. Then they start disliking you. Then they start giving negative comments. And they're not going to be very close to you because they are feeling uneasy with you. The point is, once you've achieved something, you should make people more comfortable with you to come to you so that they also learn how to succeed like you. The next thing is a mouse in you. You who is too timid to speak up on any subject. See, the tortoise was, I'm not going to give my ideas. I'm not going to do anything, just withdrawing. Whereas a mouse is, you have an idea, there's a willingness to say, but you are timid to express. Please understand, when you're timid to express, your ideas, your knowledge, your intelligence goes unexposed. Just because you're timid. It is not that you did not have the idea, but you did not have the courage. As I told you, just get out of that of the shell of saying fear of failure. Say, I will try it. Let us see if it works out. Be open. One thing I want to tell you, nobody's remembering all the things you've done all the time. It is just that after 2 days, even my talk, after 3-4 days, you're going to forget. You understand what I'm trying to say? Why is it? Because it is something is there which is happening. And people will act on it for a given period of time. And after that, it becomes irrelevant or it may come to use when necessary. But you have something more important the next day to do. So when such a thing is happening, let us not fear. Let us not be timid. Let us try to share our thoughts and ideas. The next thing is a monkey in you. One who fools around, chatters a lot, and prevents a group from concentrating on any serious business. Yeah, most of the times we become monkeys because we are bored. We find that the activity that we are doing is not challenging. The activity that we are doing is not recognized. It is irritating. It is monotonous. That's the reason why we are behaving in a way where we just want to talk or move around, disturb others because you are not happy with what you're doing. So the problem is, instead of doing this, you try to find out, why is it that I am getting so distracted? Why is it that I am trying to distract others? Similarly, when you find somebody distracting you, you have to just stop and think, why is he doing this? Why is he doing this? He is not happy with what he is doing. Or something is preventing him from achieving something. Let us try to sit and find out what is the problem, that how I can help him. Next is the cat in you, who is looking for sympathy. It's so difficult for me, meow. So what does it say? Always trying to say, I can't do it. It's difficult for me. Others are doing. Others are privileged. Others have the capacity. Maybe I'm too old. Maybe I'm too young. I do not have all the support that I need. all of us have problems, but we have different problems in different degrees. So we cannot, what I'm trying to say is, look for sympathy. Looking for sympathy, maybe people can become sympathetic, and maybe sometimes they become a little empathetic also. But if that's going to be a routine personality, people will dislike to associate. What would they think? This fellow doesn't want to do anything. He just wants some kind of sympathy. He doesn't want to put in any active effort. And then they start ignoring you. And after a point, they'll say, okay, it doesn't matter whether he's there or not. Then a donkey in you is one who is very stubborn and will not change his point of view. We sometimes are donkeys, and we meet a lot of donkeys in our life. So what are they? These people are stubborn people and will not change their point of view. Yes. So first thing is, for such stubborn people, my personal advice and experience is, don't bother to change them, because the willingness to change is not there. It's just that they've made up their mind not to change, or we behave in such a way that we don't want to change. This is how I'm going to be. So with such people, what you have to do is provide them situation, show them places or can give them opportunities where they try to see sense. Try to understand themselves and get convinced themselves that what they are doing or seeing is or behaving is not wrong. They are being stubborn for the sake of being stubborn. This is what in psychology, what Mays called it as confirmed non-conformist. They want to be non-conformist. It's a kind of personality trait. Okay. See, this may work out with few relationships. For example, you have a husband who's like that. You're not going to change your husband for life. Okay, you say, okay, I put up with it. This is how it is, fine. But this is not going to happen in a place where you're working, in an organization. It's not going to happen when you're friends. Because in a relationship, when it comes, I can do without him. Nobody's going to make an effort, or nobody's going to make an effort to put up with you. Sometimes when you're stubborn, people come to a point, I said, doesn't matter whether he exists or not. He's of no help to me. He's of no use to me. He's making my life miserable. And if such is the case, I can be without that person. So here, when you are behaving like that in a group of thing, you might lose friends. Then a rabbit in you who senses tension and conflict or unpleasant job, and he quickly switches on to another topic, changes a job, or does something that which is not so unpleasant. So what do we do is, when we see or find things that which are not very, very easy, that which gives us tension and conflict, we immediately withdraw. So withdrawing is one way of doing things. The next thing is, what you have to do is, you have to learn how to conflict or how to deal with conflict with one another. A lion in you is the one who flights whenever others disagree with his plans or interfere with this desire. So what happens is there is a lion who gets in and flights when the others disagree with his plans or interfere with this. So what happens, a lion? No, always he thinks only when people agree with him, he will remain in the group. He thinks he is the boss. So when you have this type of attitude or feeling, when you have such kind of feeling or such kind of attitude, then it becomes very, very difficult. Then there is a snake in you who hides in the grass and strikes you unexpectedly. So what these people, we have plenty. We experience it. Sometimes I tell you, we also do it. We might do it unintentionally or intentionally, but we have to be very, very careful, because when you're doing something unexpectedly, it itself means that people did not think or did not expect this kind of behavior from you. Why? They trusted you. They said that he is on my side. He is the one who is going to be with me. All that I would like to say is, instead of putting whatever you say in public, all that you could do is discuss with them, try to sort out the problem, then bring to a public platform. An elephant in you who simply blocks the way and stubbornly prevents a group from continuing the road to their goal. So now what happens with this? What is an elephant in you? it stubbornly prevents the group from progressing. It is the stumbling block, that which stops you from progressing. So sometimes what happens, when do we do this? When you cannot, when you become jealous, when you cannot see somebody progressing, or when you find that people are more successful, then you are lagging behind. Or and this is the time, what do? You try to tell wrongs, you pass on wrong information, you try to say something ill about them, and all this is unasked for. Come on, let us be large-hearted. Let the group continue. If we can contribute, we will contribute, or learn from that group how they are successful, and next time we could practice their own, that same method to become successful. The rhino in you is who charges around, putting his foot in it and upsetting people unnecessary. We have many rhinos in our life who just come unasked. Those who are even not wanted, those who are not called for, but they will butt their nose in. You know what a rhino does? Just comes, upsets the people unnecessarily. You're not even invited. Why the hell are you going there and trying to talk or contribute? They didn't ask you. Nobody wants free advice. If they want something from you, they will come to you. You keep quiet. And what happens in the bargain? You lose your respect. You might be shouted in public. You might be told, please don't interfere. I have not asked you. I don't want free advice. Why did you get all this? Because you charge there putting your foot in it, unasked. And you can go interfere. Interfere when you are accepted. You don't go charge into a group or in a relationship. First, find out whether you're wanted. Because most of the time, we are not wanted. We assume we are wanted and we try to make our presence felt. Nobody wants you. All of them have their own ways of thinking, working and doing things. If they want something, they will approach and then you contribute. The frog in you is the one who croaks on and on about the same subject in a monotonous voice. This is sickening. This is sickening to a point that they put up for some time, then they insult you. Why are you asking for insult? Why did they insult you? Because they didn't like the way you behave. Now, what do? You get angry saying that they've insulted you. No, you asked for it. You have something to discuss. You have something to say. You say it once. Then you wait to see if it is received well. If it is not received well, maybe what you said is not accepted. What you said, it was not the right time. Or what you said is irrelevant to the things that are happening around. And you go on and on and on. You're making a fool of yourself. I'm sorry to say, when you go on talking about a thing and when people are not even looking at you, not even answering you or carrying on doing something else, nothing can be most embarrassing than this for you. Let this frog in you not keep croaking. Then there is an hippopotamus in you. One who sleeps all the time, never puts his head up except to yawn. This is something that you don't do anything at all. Then you come up with some idea or something after everything is over and you try to say it should have happened like this. It could have happened like this. What did you do? You did nothing. You slept throughout and then you come up saying something very, you might think it's useful, but nobody's going to pay heed to it because you've told it at the end of the event. An owl in you is one who looks very solemn and pretends to be very wise, always talking in long words and complicated words and trying to impress others. Because you can't impress people for a long time. You can't fool people for a very, very long time. Because when you're pretending, it's going to show someday. Your wisdom should be in your action rather than your talking. So if I believe in something, if I do it, then people will take it. If I'm going to talk about something that I haven't done or if I'm not convinced, nobody is going to believe or nobody is going to take it seriously. So all this wise talk, talking long words, complicated words, using bombastic English words, all this is just momentary. You actually haven't reached the people, except that you got a satisfaction. Oh, I spoke to them something. And everybody's impressed. I'm sorry to tell you, very few would have actually taken it because they know you're just pretending. Dealing with difficult people. Who are these difficult people? The mourners who murmur and grumble. this is a very, very, very painful company you might have in your life, who always murmuring and grumbling. Not only they're making their life unpleasant, they're making your life unpleasant. So what do? You try to explain to them, please don't do it, it's not good for you. Next thing is, please don't come to me. You have something to say, you already told this to me before, there's no explanation to be given more. You want to moan, go sit and moan alone. Then the bullies are the ones who keep complaining, finding faults with others, saying this should have been done, that should have been done, and nothing happens. If he's going to be a leader or an achiever, he is going to be not complaining or bullying, he's going to be acting effectively, acting in a particular way to elicit the best behavior of people around you. Who are the shirkers? Who avoids duty and work? And I'll tell you, these are shirkers are the ones who are going to do more output by talking rather than performance. Because they avoid duty, they avoid work, so they want to make their presence felt, though they keep talking some rubbish. Then the backstabbers are people with inferiority complex. These are the ones who might have been failures. See, please understand, failure is not a total failure. We cannot be total failures in life. We can be failures in a particular part or a particular event or a particular aspect. All of us are sane people, capable people, successful in different arenas, and still we can become better in what we are doing. But we could have failed in certain things, and let us not make it an excuse and put it as a mask and say, you know, I am a failure and all that. That is over. It's an old story. So you know you're a failure. Now what next should be your concern? The time wasters are people without common sense. It's very well said that people who are wasting time do not have any sense, because people with sense value time. So time wasters are people who have no sense at all, because you know the time is the most precious thing that can never be got. Negative people are ones and thoughts and words and deeds who keep on finding faults with others, and teasers are ones who provoke others. Now, what is the solution to all these problems? Be naturally agreeable people. If you can't agree, at least don't tell them you disagree, or you say you disagree in a very polite way, or you try to avoid arguments, because arguments does not pay. What are you doing when you're arguing? Nobody's listening. Each one is telling his own point of view. Who's the listener? Who's the learner? Nobody. It's just waste of time for both the party to say their ideas. Doesn't it look very stupid? Each one telling what they're convinced about, not convincing the other, because the listener is not in the frame of mind to listen. So avoid arguments. Whereas if that's going to be communication, then it is meaningful. You say, this is why I believe. So what is your idea about it? Why do you think that way? That is communication. Argument is not a good form of positive communication. When you are wrong, please apologize sincerely. It's not lip service. Say, yes, I'm wrong. I will not do it, or I've done it, maybe a bit of my ignorance, because I never thought about it, maybe I overlooked, I will not do. Come on, we all know we make faults. See, but the beauty is, we are not interacting with perfect people. So they're also doing some mistake. So thereby, we are also doing some mistake. So nobody is superior, nobody is inferior. You can be superior and inferior as far as your status is concerned, your age is concerned, fine. As far as learning is concerned, both are on the same platform. So you have learned something new today, you made a mistake, apologize. That person might not have even tried, so it's okay. So for bullies, please don't use harsh words. As we say, that words are remembered more than the deeds. Then smile. When you really want to scream, smile. Promise only when you can deliver. This is another big, big problem we have. I can do this, I will do it, all these things we say, and actually, I'm trying to tell you, we mean it. I'm not saying we're trying to cheat them or we're trying to give false hopes. But sometimes what happens is so many things go out of control. When you keep on failing promises, people lose trust in you. So the problem is that you have promised without doing your homework properly. Without doing your homework properly, it means that did you really find out, is the goal realistic? Is the environment very congenial? Do I have any tangible methods to overcome the problem? Will I be able to deliver it on time? So when you do this little homework, then give your promise, then you'll be able to deliver. Then dream, but with your eyes wide open. The same thing is dream, knowing all the consequences, the responsibilities, the opportunities, your strength, your weaknesses, and then you work. Just dreaming without knowing yourself or people or things around you, it is never going to come true. Work like there is no tomorrow. So what do we do, especially when we eat? We say, don't eat acid, you know, it's going to be your last meal. Don't eat acid, there's no tomorrow. So that we are doing it because we enjoy doing it. We like it. But I think we should start even liking to work, because that is part of our life. So that is what is going to keep our life going. So the problem is, when you think of work, we look at it as a burden rather than part of our lifestyle. When you try to objectify it, then it becomes a problem. When you say it is mine, I'm doing it, then you will enjoy doing what you're doing. Always be honest. Would you want others to lie to you? Be there when they need you, or you may wind up alone. This is, again, many times it happens. We think we are very smart. When somebody needs you, you just try to shy away or just be out of the scene or pretend that you never knew about it. Don't pick up calls or put your phones in mute, because you already know that the person needs you. Okay, even if you say if you can't help him in a way of, say, monetarily, or maybe you cannot reach him there physically, at least you can say, yes, boss, what can I do? At least you can listen to him and try to help him. Cheer them on. We all need encouragement. Please understand, do unto others what you want others to do unto you. As simple as that. If you want somebody to be nice to you, you be nice to them. Very, very simple. Life is not complicated if you understand that. Don't look for others' faults. This is another important thing. Is we never try to look at people's qualities. We never try to look for some good nature, but eyes are wide open to look at their faults. Encourage dreams. What do we do without them? We need dreams, because only when we have dreams, we are going to progress. Forgive them. This is very, very important. Forgive and forget. We are not the ultimate. We have what mistake he did today, we might do tomorrow, or we might do different mistakes. And we also need people to forgive us. So when we get an opportunity to forgive, please do it. Get together often, have faith in others, include them. We need to be included. And it is actually good to be with people, offer to help. No thanks, it is just politeness. All these phrases which always say, you know, say thank you, say sorry. So these are the things which are very, very simple words, but carry a lot of meaning, emotion. And I will tell you, this little thank you and sorry that you've given it to them on time is going to be remembered, and they feel good for what they have done for you. Or if you've done something wrong and if you've said sorry, at least say, okay, that fellow has at least realized it. Praise honestly. Praise openly. Don't be stingy when you're complimenting. Be liberal, be nice, be good. What is it that you're losing? Why is it that you have to be miserly when you're complimenting somebody, when you're saying something good to somebody? All are kind of the highest degree to be a miser comes when you want to compliment. Why? It's free, no? Give it a large quantity. Make the other person happy. Quietly disagree, noisy no makes enemies. This is very, very important. My God, we meet people. We are bound to disagree. It is natural to disagree, but don't make a noise. It is damn irritating for the people around you and for yourself also. When you are shouting, when somebody is shouting, you don't like it. Because you don't like it, you're shouting more. How stupid. If you're all started by just disagreeing it in a very quiet way, the whole place is going to be heaven. Then really listen. Friendly ear is a soothing balm. So this is what Vishas already told you. Please listen. Say sorry. Don't let them assume it. This is very important. Most of the time when we want to do something, we quickly assume that he knows I'm feeling bad. He might know, but when you say it, it is confirmed. Just knowing and getting a confirmation is different, right? You, for example, you want to go somewhere. your friend says, okay, we're going for a movie. And then he's bought a ticket, fine. But you've told him, usually he buys a ticket, so you're fine. But are you convinced, are you sure that the ticket is bought unless he calls up and tells you, boss, I bought the tickets, let's go for a movie. So at that moment, you don't want assumption. You want a very clear message saying, yes, da, as it's planned, we are going out. But why is it when it comes to say things like, sorry, you want to say, let him assume. We let him think that he should have known by now. He says he saw my expression. Why can't you be verbal? You were verbal when you were not asked for. You were verbal when it was very unnecessary. Why can't you be verbal when it is just necessary by just saying a small word of sorry? Talk frequently. Communication is important. Use judgment. Verbalize your feeling. Again, when you're verbalizing your feeling, verbalize it in the sense, choose the right word at the right time, right quantity, limit it, see the response. This is very, very important. When you're communicating your feeling, see the response. How are they responding to you? Is it that they're liking it? Are you giving an overdose of it? Do you have to reduce it? Or do you have to give it in parts and parcel? So we have to check and accordingly do it. It's because there's no one recipe for all people. There's one way we have to keep working. Wish them luck. Hopefully good. Examine your work. Your words count. Use them wisely. A smile is valuable commodity because a smile costs less than electricity and gives more light. So this is what it is that I wanted to share with you. And I think I'll get back to you. I think you saw the PPT. Now I'm open for questions. Please come out with your questions. Thank you so much for your patient listening.
Thank you very much, ma'am. It was a very interesting session, and there were many comments which said that it was very interesting, it was very useful, and it was very inspiring. Thank you very much for such an inspiring session, ma'am.
Thank you.
And there were a few questions which came in the chat box. One was, at what age can we start teaching interpersonal skills to a child?
Interpersonal relationship starts from birth. There's nothing for us to teach. See, here, what is actually interpersonal relationship? How is it that we are reacting to other people? And how is it that we expect others to react to our expectation? That's the interpersonal relationship. So from the time we are born, a child knows how to go about when with the parents. If it's a father, how does it react? It tries to be very quiet and nice. If it's a mother, it's demanding, loud, screams. If it's going to be an uncle, the child, we naturally develop the skill of interpersonal relationship. And only thing is, it's not the age, it's a question of we try to watch them and try to see that they're developing the positive aspect of interrelationship. Like for all the positive things that I said, that should be monitored. There's no age. Once you're born, you're interacting. Once you're interacting, you have got the skill and you develop the skill as you are growing. Our success and failures help us to develop our skills. A little bit of learning, little bit of other people's experience, knowledge, all this helps us. And sometimes most of it, interpersonal skills are imitating. You see a father screaming, the son screams because he thinks that's the accepted way. So this is how we learn interpersonal skills. Any question?
Another question was, how can we know the correct bar of expectation, or how much to expect from our relationships? I guess that's what she meant.
Yeah. See, the question is, when you're talking about this itself, your relationship itself, you're not even know your degree of relationship. You understand what I'm trying to say? When you're not clear what to expect, you're not clear about the relationship. So when you're talking about relationship, what are we talking about? How far and no further? How much can I interact with this person? What does he like? What does he dislike? So best is, when you're not too sure, you keep in contact, but don't get personal. The so-called social distancing we are talking about is actually physical distancing. Here, I'm talking about the real social distance. For example, you try to work on one aspect at a time. And first start off with an aspect that the person likes. Then try to change what he doesn't like. Then slowly say, how does the relationship come? basically remember a relationship based on two things, either on love or on respect. If neither two are there, no relationship is going to last. Either you work on the love. Love means doesn't mean to talk. I'm not talking about this romantic love. Love means a kind of respect and kind of attending to their feelings as not to hurt. What is loving? You're doing something that it will not hurt the other person whom you care. So if this is your criteria, find out what is it that he needs. Then work on the positive aspect. Then you try to get closer.
Okay. And another question was, are these animals always there in every human being?
All the time, always. They are all present. But given situation, it comes and goes. So it is very natural. We are having everything within us. Given situation, it appears and it's natural to appear. See, as I told you, we are not perfect. The environment around us is not perfect. We are not perfect. Demands are different. Demands are changing. So when things are like this, this is actually a kind of what we call as a defense mechanism, isn't it? We've all learned about defense mechanism. So you avoid. Why? Because you're not able to handle. You tell a lie because you do not know any other way to escape. So, and you strike somebody from the back like a snake. Why? You can't think of any other option but to save yourself, to say that. So this is there. But how do you grow out of all this negative thing is? Very simple is practice universal love. I'm telling you, this is what is very, very important. So what? Let them grow. We are growing. So once you have this kind of thing, you are happy. Forget the whole world. You are happy. What is there? If Rajita ma'am has called me, I'm going to come and deliver. I didn't even know from her where she got my name, how she contacted. Nothing mattered at all. She just said she called up and said, give a talk. So there was no question of anything. I mean, I didn't look at it. What did somebody's asked me? Therefore, I am going to respond. You understand? If this is the way we are going to go about it, I am feeling good because I was asked to do it and I'm delivering it. I didn't have to see the pros and cons. Who is it? What? Nothing at all. I mean, you can ask her straight away. She requested. I said, okay. So, I mean, when you start practicing this, we are feeling good and even people will feel good around us, which is more important.
Thank you very much, ma'am. And the last question is there any way to change the people with elephants in them? So I think it applies to all the,
See, what happens is when does a person behave like an elephant is, he stops the growth of others, right? He stands in between. That's what we spoke about the elephant, where he comes and blocks. He is one who is doing the blocking job. Why is he doing the blocking job is what we have to find out. The reasons could be he could have been a competitor, right? He could have been unsuccessful, or he could be jealous that you are winning. These are all normal things that keep happening. So what is it that we have to do is we just have to do a little bit of introspection. Once we start feeling jealous, we have to do introspection. I will very quickly we'll find out, hey, I did not do it maybe because I didn't get the capacity. I don't have the capacity. I may not have the opportunity. I did not get the support. This fellow is lucky. He's able to do it. Come on, let him do it. Maybe let me see what he's done and maybe I'll do it better than him next time. So if you're going to take it in a positive way, then you're not going to be the elephant there.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you for patiently answering all the questions. And we are very grateful to you for accepting our invitation without any hesitation. And it was a very interesting talk, which would have definitely benefited everybody who has attended. Thank you very much, ma'am. On behalf of our management, principal, and the whole college, I would like to thank you for this session. Thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Bye. I'll take leave, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you very much. Bye.